Greetings, everyone. Blue Goblin here for a comic book review for this particular week of November 2016. The exact date's kind of slipping my mind right now, so I'll just be sure to put it in the title. Got a lot to cover and a lot of questionable honesty. Gonna go through Marvel and DC, and we're gonna end with IDW. There's a reason I want to end with IDW. Trust me. Start with Marvel. We start with All New X-Men Annual Number 1. Good issue. Good. Very good. It's a two-story split. The first one is with ID, or I believe she calls herself Oya, or whatever. But, I like this character. I really do. You know, able to manipulate fire and fire and water, or fire and ice, excuse me. Her and the young X-Men are out on the mall, and she comes across a young man and decides to go out on a date. And of course, what happens when a mutant goes out in public? They come across your stereotypical redneck bigot, you know, caricatures. You know, the ones that, you know, throw bricks at things that are different than them, and it's just really kind of a predictable stereotype, you know, as far as bigot-like characters are concerned. You know, the young man that she's out on a date with gets hit by a brick by these bigots, and they all decide to, you know, gang up on her, and of course she ones up all of their dumb asses and leaves a little note says, I assaulted an underage girl and I lost. Leaving that little note on one of their unconscious bodies. I thought that was a really cute little ew to those guys. And the second story with Danny Moonstar, that was also really good. You know, with Danny confronting Lady Mastermind. But the reason why, that was nice. That was a nice touch. This was a really fun issue. I really dug this. Thought it was good. Is it worth $5? In my opinion, just barely, in my opinion. But I still would only recommend this for, you know, diehard collectors of X-Men books. Doesn't really add anything significant to the ongoing narrative that this title is going through right now. But if you want a good, fun little read and you're already collecting this title and following these characters, then I'd say go ahead and pick it up. It wouldn't hurt. It was a great read, though, for what it was. Overpriced, of course, but it's an annual. What do you expect? Give it a 3.5 out of 5. Let's keep the annuals rolling. The Amazing Spider-Man Annual Number 1. I know I try to keep up with the traditional numbering for Amazing Spider-Man, but as far as keeping up with traditional numbering for annuals, it's just like, oh my god. Like, how many fucking annual number ones has this title gone through? It's like Marvel is just too afraid of long... Let me try and rephrase that. Marvel is becoming too scared of longevity. It almost feels like they're ashamed that this title has gone on so long. It's like, oh, we can't say that this title's in its 700s and this is probably the 43rd annual. It makes the title sound old. We gotta keep it fresh. Number one this, and number one that, and Amazing Spider-Man's only in the 20s. You know, if I'm running Marvel, I'd stick with their traditional numbering. Show off its prestige. Show off its longevity. Embrace it. Accept it. Be proud of it. This is a character that's been around for over 50 years. I can understand wanting to keep things fresh, but you can keep things fresh and show its prestige at the same time. There is ways to make that work. I just don't get it sometimes. With that being said, this issue was still fun. This is a three-story split book. The first story involving the artifact, the mask and everything, that was fine. It was fun. The artwork was a bit on the Ren and Stimpy-ish side. A little bit. I thought it was fine. The second story with Cloak and Dagger, that one was really good. The third story... Oh, excuse me. This is a hell of a time to get something in my eye. Okay, where was I? Yeah, the third story, I thought was fine too. Everything just seemed to work. The third story that was written by Wayne Brady and Jonathan Mangum from Let's Make a Deal. Yes, the hosts of Let's Make a Deal wrote a story for Amazing Spider-Man. It was basically showcasing their love of improv by having Spidey take improv classes because apparently his humor's not good enough. I'm like, whatever. But all three stories were fine as they were. But as far as, you know, adding this book to your collection, I'd say skip it. I mean, the issue was fine, the stories were fine, but I would only recommend this for diehard Spider-Man fans. Casual fans, you don't need it. 3.5 out of 5. Civil War 2, number 7. Look, you guys. This is one of the things that's just truly amazing about Marvel. Marvel gives you a story. And you think the story's going in a certain direction, and when they're about finished with it, they've taken it another direction. And as far as supporting any of the characters is concerned, at this stage in the game, I don't know who to support anymore. I don't get it. I don't... The way this storyline was progressing as the plot developed and went on and on and on, I was leaning toward Tony Stark being the right one and Carol just being just completely batshit crazy drunk with power, wanting to control everything, wanting the world to work the way she wants it to work, and, you know, playing God and stopping catastrophes before they happen, arresting people for stuff they're not even aware that they're gonna do. You know, it's like some jack-off's eye starts to glow. She sees something and goes, oh, you're under arrest. Why? What'd I do? You know, it's going on to an all-new high. The last issue made her just look like she was losing her mind, obsessed with keeping everybody in control, in her control. And then we get to this. We once again see the image of Miles Morales standing over a dead Captain America as if we haven't seen that goddamn image enough. And then we get to what this issue is truly about. This is the issue where I feel Bendis and Marquez and everybody that has been working on this storyline has completely just shifted this storyline into a progression that I'm not fond of, where I don't know whether to cheer for Tony or say, Tony, what the hell is the matter with you? Why are you snapping like this? And what's even more frustrating is that the characters, especially Ulysses, is trying to subliminally tell us readers that we're not supposed to know who to root for until the storyline is over. I'm sorry, that is a major, major flaw when it comes to writing. You're writing a storyline that's taking months to tell. A good story should be able to grip us and make us support a character the whole way through, not make us flip on them. I was preaching about how Tony was right and Carol was wrong, in my honest opinion. Now, I don't know what the fuck to think. Thanks a lot, Bendis. Thank you very much. I don't know anymore. I really don't. The artwork is still fantastic. The writing is still gripping, whether it's for the right or wrong reasons. I want to see how this story ends. Because if anything else, Bendis did succeed at one thing. He's keeping my attention. And I'm willing to bet. I may not be willing to bet money on this because I'm not much of a gambler. But I would almost be willing to bet the conclusion of this storyline is seriously going to piss me off. But I gotta know. I've made it this far. I gotta see how it ends. So this book, this particular issue, I guess you would say it's a successful failure? Which is an oxymoron, but that's honestly the best way I can possibly try to describe the bullshit I'm seeing in here. And Maria Hill's a bitch. 3 out of 5, and that's being generous. Death of X, number 4. I'm going to sum this issue up, this entire story, Death of X, up in one sentence. Screw you, Emma Frost. 2 out of 5. Moving on. Han Solo, number 4. 5, excuse me. Marjorie Liu, thank you. We're finally getting a break from the bullshit like this and getting onto something good. This was a fitting conclusion to this storyline where, you know, Han, smuggler, scoundrel, hero, nobleman? I don't know, but, you know, the Dragon Void, the race is reaching its climax, and Han's literally got the Empire on his ass, and, get your mind out of the gutter. The Empire is chasing the Millennium Falcon down. The Empire is trying to stop this race. The way the race is supposed to finish, there's a really big twist at the end for who wins, the winner's reward and the loser's penalty. Ooh, that's nice. But I liked the little loophole that they threw in there to ensure that Han may have lost, but he still wins. You know, it's just one of those things. It's like, yeah, okay, I get it. It was good. It was really good. They find out who the traitor is, and I was like, wow, really? All this build-up, and that's what you give us? Okay. Kind of disappointing there. That's just my opinion. But still, fitting story, great stuff, good character development, especially for Han Solo. I read this entire story, and I was just like, yeah, that's Han Solo. That's the way he is. He's a scoundrel, he's a bastard, but damn it, we love the guy. And this was good. Marjorie Liu did a good job. Very impressed. This conclusion was good. Not as great as I expected it to be, but it was still really, really fascinating, really satisfying. I give it a 4. Yeah, perfect time for the fucking train to come through. Let's just keep going on. Mighty Thor, number 13, Jason Aaron. Thank you! Oh my god! What is it? What are you sprinkling in your Kool-Aid, Mr. Aaron? God, you gotta share some of that shit. This is great stuff. Solid writing. I don't... Choo-choo to you, too. But... blow me. What is it that makes Jason Aaron... You better shut the hell up. What I say? It's what I thought. You want to mess with me, motherfucker? Quit blowing the damn horn. We know you're out there. All right, where was I? Yes, Jason Aaron. What is it about? He's got such a special gift when it comes to writing Thor, whether it's Odinson or Jane Foster. He just has it. He's got just as good a connection to Thor as Mark Waid had to Daredevil. Yes, I'm going that far. This was great. Not Aaron's best issue, I'll admit that, but it is still just fantastic stuff to read. Thor's trying to liberate the elves from Malekith's control, but she knows she can't do it alone, and she brings in reinforcements, but then they hit a humongous bump in the road, as seen at the cliffhanger. Damn, this was great. This was impressive. Loved it. A 4. Spider-Gwen, number 14. Wow. I was speaking of, you know, my analogy with Daredevil, and here we have Matt Murdock in this world. For those of you who are not familiar with Matt Murdock in Spider-Gwen's world, for those of you who don't collect Spider-Gwen, let me just put it to you like this. He ain't no Daredevil. Matt Murdock in this universe is the kingpin of crime. And he is a 100% uncut first class douchebag. I mean, the man's about as charming as freaking Negan is in The Walking Dead. It's like Gwen's having a serious heart-to-heart chat with her dad, visiting him in prison, and Murdock is just being fucking dick throughout about it. And it's a unique twist on the character, and I guess you can get away with it since it's an alternate world. But still, not bad. The progression is going very well. This is good stuff. Now, I gotta be honest, the series has been slipping a little bit the past few issues. You know, the whole Halloween specials and everything like that. It's starting to pick back up for me. I like where they're going with this. I'm hoping that they can keep stretching this out because, you know, the whole Spider-Gwen's powers are now temporary and everything like that. But I'm sticking with it to see where they go and see how they can progress everything. But so far, it's still pretty good. Solid read. I give it a 3 or 3.5 at best. Oh, shit. Excuse me. Put that down right there. Let's end the Marvel stack with Star Wars number 25. Jason Aaron. Oh, my God. I mean, the dude has the touch with Thor, and he has a touch with Star Wars. This was awesome. Don't know why it's $5. You mean to tell me just because it's number 25, it's got to be $5. So I'm willing to bet issue number 50, if they make it that long, will be $5. It's like Marvel is easily the greediest comic book publisher in the market, because whenever something monumental in their minds happens or something hits a landmark issue number, they got to jack the price up. It's like, oh, this was written by a celebrity, so it's $5. It's an annual, it's $5. It's number 25, it's $5. Or, you know, it's like, this issue came out on the same day as the first issue came out like 30 years ago. Don't know what the number is, but it's going to be $5. Or something, maybe $7 or $8. Yeah, or it's the beginning. Really? Screw you. But this, I think, was fully worth the $5. And I'll be a son of a bitch. You're going to keep on going. How rude. We get it. freaking horn. I'm sitting here trying to read a review a comic book. No, keep going. Don't stop on my count. Keep going, motherfucker. I'll be here all night if I have to. I'm sure they're patient. I'll be patient too. Keep tooting your horn, son of a bitch. Let's keep. Okay, let's get back to it. Fully worth $5, in my opinion. Fully worth $5. So much shit's going on in here. The rebels are trying to protect themselves, you know, trying to, you know, survive on this Star Destroyer that they confiscated. The Star Destroyer literally has only one engine. Their shields are just non-existent at this point. You got TIE fighters on their ass. You got stormtroopers in the Star Destroyer fighting them. And on top of all that, Vader's out there and he's on his way. All kinds of crazy shit's going on around here. I mean, they've literally got their backs against the wall. And somehow, some way, through some sort of miracle or the Force, they're able to survive the day. But by the end of the story, we learn it wasn't a complete victory. The Empire may have lost, but they didn't get away empty-handed. And I'm just going to leave it at that. This was a phenomenal read. So much craziness is going on, but everything kept my focus. Everything kept my attention. It was great. An easy 4 out of 5 for me. Let's keep rolling. Starting with DC off with Action Comics 968, Dan Jurgens. I salute you, my man. This is great stuff. This is the next part of the Men of Steel storyline. But in here, you know, the God Slayer is going after Luthor. And his big muscle-headed cohort is having his hands full with Superman. And things are looking down for Superman until Superboy, his son John, sticks in and says, "Hey, back off. It's my dad." And they're just like, "Oh boy, all right. We'll finish off Luthor somewhere else." And that's when Lois and the other Clark Kent catch up with Superman. And the other Clark Kent makes a monumental statement at the end of the issue. It's like seeing Clark Kent say what he said at the end of the book just blew my mind, and it just looks so out of character. But at the same time, this Clark Kent is not Superman. But still, to see a character that has that trademarked look, to see a character that has been like this for God knows how many decades say what he said, it just looks weird. But it's still a gripping story, and I know DC's going to swerve us and say, you know, it's like, well, yeah, the way that sometimes they progress things in a switch to make the story better, and I'm hoping that Dan Jurgens can do that. This was good. An easy 4 out of 5. Let's move on to Batgirl number 5. You know, I believe it was Gail Simone that said, somebody asked her about the current state of Batgirl. What's her thoughts on the current state of Batgirl since she left the title? And, you know, it's weird. I had thoughts and opinions like this myself, but I wasn't sure if it was right to feel this way until I saw what she said. She says that, you know, it's one thing to make Batgirl seem younger, but it's a whole other thing to where Batgirl looks less experienced in means of combat. And I was like, yeah, she's actually right, folks. I'm not just saying that as a fanboy. I'm saying that because she's right. You know, making Batgirl seem younger, because when Gail was on the title, Batgirl seemed more mature, but she was one hell of a fighter. I mean, there was some... She was handing out ass whoopings as if it was easy. She could do it with her eyes shut. Now that she's no longer on the title and we have new creative teams on the character, there are times where Batgirl comes off less experienced. It's as if you're taking a captain in the police force and demoting him down to sergeant. It, you know, some of her skills seem a little bit more lacking. You know, it's kind of like they hit a time warp and just said, stop right there. We're just gonna progress it here instead of there, where it should be progressed. You know, I don't really have a problem with them making her appear to be younger than she's probably supposed to be. Something like that, it can bother some people, but it's easily forgivable over time. But when you have the characters seem so less skilled in terms of combat, it really does bother me, and it really does present a total flaw in terms of character development. In here, she's dealing with the so-called the teacher. She's getting, you know, visions of the fruit bat and her friend Kai in her head. And the best way to deal with this villain is to turn off her eidetic memory. How does that work? You know, it's like, turn off your memory, but then you see the vision that's going to just turn it back on. I'm sorry, that's just lame. And it's just... there are times where this character just seems so downgraded. And it's really painful. But I love this character so much, and I want to see this continue to succeed. Yet at the same time, it's insulting to a degree what you're doing with her. This issue was fine, and it seems like in the next issue she's going to come back to Burnside and have a rendezvous with Poison Ivy. Now that I'm looking forward to. This issue, it was okay at best. Because this may be a little bit biased, but I love this character very much, so I'm going to be extra generous and give it up to a 3 out of 5 at the very best. Batman Beyond number 2. Oh, shit. This was good. This was good. I was kind of taken aback about, you know, what Terry decided to do at the end of the last issue. But considering seeing what him and the rest of the remaining members of the Bat family do in here, okay. Now I'm interested. We also get a glimpse as to what allegedly happened between Bruce and the Joker in one of their many final confrontations. We're seeing more of the Joker's gang, more of their mentalities and more of their reasoning behind resurrecting the Joker. And, you know, there's like their logic is like, well, Superman died once it came back. Why can't the Joker do it? You know, it's just a bunch of fanatics wanting to resurrect an idol that may or may not respect them. You know, it's like you want to look at these guys and say, look, okay, what if your plan works and you do resurrect the Joker? You think he's going to thank you? If he thinks there's some sick laugh out of it, he may just pull out a gun and just blow your head off just for the fun of it. Oh, it's like, oh, thanks for reviving me. Boom. Now you're dead. That's what I see Joker doing. And, you know, Dan Jurgens is such a great writer. I honestly wouldn't mind seeing him do that. It's like the Joker wakes up after being dead for so many years. So how does he repay the people who brought him back to life? He kills them. Because that is something the Joker would do. But as far as Terry's undercover work is concerned, I liked the name the alias he gave himself. That was a nice touch. Fun issue. A 3.5 out of 5. Let's move on to Detective Comics number 945. long story short, there's dissension in the ranks of the Batman family in here, primarily between Bruce and Stephanie. That's getting really tense. I'm hoping that they're not leaning towards a spoiler, leaning towards Stephanie completely turning her back and breaking off from Bruce. However, there are some things that Stephanie says in here about Bruce that you go, yeah, as much as we hate to admit it, she's right. It's just the truth, folks. Batman's a pompous ass. No matter how much we love the guy, how much we worship this superhero, at the end of the day, he's a psychotic, pompous ass. That's the truth. Accept it. Y'all right in there, baby? Okay. But still, a good issue nonetheless. And that cliffhanger, I'm sure a lot of people want to know my thoughts about that cliffhanger. I smell a rat. And more likely, I smell a bit of a hologram swerve here. I'm not buying it. Not buying it that that's a legit turn in the story and a legit turn in the narrative. Not buying it. Not buying it at all. Then again, I could be wrong. But what I'm looking forward to is the storyline that's going to build up the return of the Batwoman series. That's what's really got my attention. But this was good. This was good. I'll give it a 3.5. Oh, let's go into some irony here. Flash number 11. You know, for the fastest man alive, this issue kind of went a little slow-paced. Williamson and Watanabe, they did a good job. The artwork was fantastic. This is some of the best artwork this title has had in a while. But yeah, this issue was kind of heavy on the exposition, and it really drags the book down. It's good to see the shade. It's really good to see shade. But the exposition, the constant, the constant lecturing, the constant dilemmas, the, you know, character tearing, you know, stuff like that. It's like, you know, I want to be good, but being bad just felt so good and everything. It's just so many things felt repetitive and redundant, and so many things just felt a little dragged and stretched out. The narrative was slowed down, and considering that this is a book focused on speedsters, that's kind of ironically funny. Then again, what do I know? I'm just a dork. I'm just a comic book geek. But it's easy for me to notice these things because I love these characters so much. I am so emotionally connected to these characters. That's why you sell the damn shit to begin with. But that being said, the issue was fine at best with a really nice cliffhanger. I just wish the pacing could have progressed a little faster. And there was really no need to repeat some of the plot points throughout the issue. It's like, okay, you've already said this, and you've already said this. You don't need to say it again, maybe once or two more times. It just drags, and it stretches it out when it doesn't really need to. It's not really necessary. But it was still good for what it was, and I'll give it a 3.5. Hal Jordan and the Green Lantern Corps, number 9. Not much really to report here. It's just that, you know, John and the Green Lantern Corps, along with Soranak and the Sinestro Corps, they deal with Starro the Conqueror in a very unique way, and that's when they find out where they're really at. Yeah, and we also get to see where Hal's really been at since the big explosion at Warworld with him and Sinestro. But who Hal runs into where he's at, who he runs into, that surprised me. I was like, whoa, really? Now that was out of left field. But, okay, so John and the rest of his crew are in deep shit. Hal's God knows where. I mean, the person he runs into tells him where he is and tells him that he's not really supposed to be there. Meanwhile, you've got Hal's ring going haywire. And then at the big reveal in the cliffhanger at the end of the book, woo! And that's it. Publish. Move on. 3.5 out of 5. Harley Quinn, number 8. Warning, this comic book may change the way you view vacations, food, tennis, retired superheroes and villains, nudist colonies, naked volleyball, bi-weekly comics, the creators and the company behind this title. Side effects may include nausea, headaches, heartburn, indigestion, diarrhea, swelling of hands, legs, and feet, and itchy, watery eyes, and psoriasis. Okay, Jimmy Palmiotti and Amanda Connor. Chad Harden. Chad Harden's artwork is great. The flashback art was great, too. This was the story I've been waiting for, to see Harley and Ivy at the Bahamas taking some time off and just enjoying their time together. And just like that, the week is over. Lots of awkwardness, lots of silly, goofy comedy, as come to expect from this title. But then the ending hit me with a bit of a surprise curveball with Harley once again asking Ivy to move in with her. She wants to live with Ivy. And I'm sitting here reading this book going, why the hell not? Go for it. I mean, you've pretty much through inside suggestions and innuendos, you've pretty much already stated that these two are a legitimate couple. Why not have them live together? It's like I said, you've already established that they are clearly way more than best friends. I mean, it's kind of obvious. You've done everything except actually say it. But then Pam hits Harley with a curveball, but not in a cruel way. And it actually breaks Harley's heart. But at the same time, Harley gets it. She understands. It's just that, you know, Pam even confesses to Harley that she deeply loves her very much. You know, it's just the way they're drawn and the way the storyline is progressing, the way the characters interact with each other. You could tell it's way more than a friendship. I mean, doesn't anybody with half a brain reading this book can get that. But, you know, I'm just one of those fans that says, what the hell? What do you got to lose? Go for it. Just be open about it. Have them live together. Have them, you know, worry about each other as a couple. Have them bicker. Have them argue. Have them make up after arguing, you know. Have them, you know, do funny, goofy shit like the stuff they did in here. You know, just go all out with it. If it doesn't work, just break them up. You know, if it doesn't help the sales or if the fans start rebelling against it, then just break them up and go back to the way you did it before. There's really no harm in trying it. I mean, seriously, what have you got to lose? Oh, wait, that's right. DC don't like superhero couples. My mistake. I forgot. I totally forgot. Just ask Aquaman, for God's sake. But the issue was fun. It was a load of fun, and I really did like it. Even with the curveball at the end that was probably meant to hit me right there, it hit me a little bit, but not too hard. I still liked the book. An easy 4 out of 5. Teen Titans number 2. Damian informs the rest of the Titans about the Demon's Fist and everything. But before that, we see a scene with, you know, Talia trying to reach out to Damian one more time. It's like, hey, look, do you want to be the grandson of Ra's al Ghul, or do you want to be the son of Batman? And we get back to the present time where Damian's consulting the Titans about the Demon's Fist, and then the Demon's Fist arrive and, you know, drop the big bombshell that Damian was meant to lead them and not the Teen Titans. And Damian's trying to convince the Titans to work together, to work with him, because at the end of the day, he chose to be known as the son of Batman rather than the grandson of Ra's al Ghul. Which is a step in the right direction with this character. It is. It really is. It shows a character growth in Damian. He's still a massive prick, and there's no getting around that. There's no arguing that. But him choosing the life of Batman over the life of an assassin, that's a step in the right direction in terms of character growth, and I really liked that. I really appreciated that. It's still... There is still one really big upsetting thing about this title is... I'm not complaining that Starfire's on the team. I love this lineup because it's the closest thing we're ever going to get to a Wolfman Perez lineup reunion. But are you still trying to tell me that Starfire is still a teenager? When her ex, Nightwing, is clearly a grown adult. What kind of relationship did they have? Because it's starting to feel creepy. But with that, all joking aside, it's still, this was fun. I dug this. 3.5. Titans number 5. I really don't know what to think about this issue. I really don't. Booth's artwork is always great. Dan Abnett's writing was solid in here. Wally doing the whole Crisis on Infinite Earths type sacrifice that he makes in here, I'm not buying it. Only 5 issues in and you're already teasing Wally West's demise? Bullshit. Bullshit. I'm not buying it. I'm really not. He does look like a true, honest-to-God hero in here because he flat-out says, if I have to die to save my friends, then that's what I'm going to have to do. Only a true hero would make a statement like that and actually follow through with it without hesitation, and I really appreciated that. It really says a lot about the character of Wally West, and Mr. Adnett, I personally do thank you for that. That was really a really nice touch. But as far as the actual actions are concerned, you know, it's like, oh, Wally West obliterated himself. He's gone. Nah. Not buying it. I'm really not buying it. Issue was fine, though, for what it was. It's just a little bit stretched as far as stretching the imagination's going. I'd give it a 3 or a 3.5 at the very best. Wonder Woman number 11, this is the conclusion of the Lies storyline. Wow. I'm just going to say it right here. Thank you, Greg Rucka. This is great shit. What a reveal about Diana. And it's also really interesting to point out that not only does Diana notice some bullshit going around, but so does Steve. I noticed that. Steve doesn't have true long-lasting memories about Themyscira, but even he notices that something ain't right. But then it's revealed at the end of the issue. Oh my God. What the hell? Amazing. A 4 out of 5. All right, we're going to end this review with IDW. Gem and the Holograms, number 21. Still great writing and still artwork. The artwork, I'm sorry. I'm tired of being nice. I'm just going to flat out say it. The artwork in here sucks. It really does. And I'm, you know, it's come to the point now where I'm just tired of being nice on this title. I just need to flat out say it. The artwork sucks. Please, IDW, get a new artist on this title. You know, I'm not trying to be a dick to the artist on this title. It's just the artwork is just bad. I don't like it at all. But this little vixen right here, Fox, is about to succeed in her mission. She's infiltrating and trying to dig up some information on the holograms. And by the end of the issue, it looks like she's found out a way to do it. Solid read as far as writing is concerned, but seriously, get a new artist. Or get the old artist back on the title. We need something different. I don't know how much more of this, like, shaky line drawing shit I can take. I don't know how much more I can take. A 3 at the very best. I wanted to end this review with a bang. Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles number 64. Mr. Eastman. Mr. Waltz. What the hell are you doing? What are you doing? Oh! Seriously! What are you doing? Oh! I mean, this cover right here should sum it up. Such a huge shift! In terms of the status quo! And it's killing me! Seriously! I read this issue at a bad time. I read this issue while I was on my lunch break at work. And I was distraught for quite a while. I don't know what to think. I really don't. And I'm speaking from the heart. I tend to speak from the heart a lot when it comes to reviewing comic books. But I'm not pulling out any gimmicks or any counterparts or any of that or any comedic bullshit here. I threw down my hat that most of my viewers say I should trademark my look with the bucket hat and everything. I'm frizzing up my hair. I'm about to pull most of my hair out. I'm at a loss for words as to what you're doing in here. I don't know. Eastman, Waltz, I'm serious. I really hope you have a good follow-up to what you're doing in here. Because I don't know if I should love this or hate this. Where you're taking the status quo with certain characters. I'm really at an emotional loss. Big emotional loss. I'm just hoping that this humongous shift you're making in the status quo will end up being for the better. Otherwise, this is gonna end up being so goddamn painful. I give it a 4 out of 5. Oh god. I'm exhausted after that. Fuck you. Thanks for watching, everybody. Please subscribe to this channel. Don't forget Blue Goblin X. Don't forget Arkham Asylum Studio. Always remember the shout outs in the description below. Thanks again for watching, everybody, and I'll see y'all later.